This Sunday brings us Super Bowl 57 between the Kansas City Chiefs and the Philadelphia Eagles. It is, of course, the culmination of the NFL season and the biggest event in American football and American sports. But what goes into preparing for such a crucial game? In this video, I'm going to talk about some of the decisions, some of the considerations from a sports science perspective that go into the preparation and game day itself. My name's Joe Club. I am a sports science consultant, and I previously worked as a sports scientist in the Premier League, the NHL, and the NFL, where I worked for the Buffalo Bills. So let's zoom out to start with to get an idea of the overall picture and what has brought the Chiefs and the Eagles to this point. So for the overall calendar of the NFL season, this is what the year looks like. The games here are highlighted, and you can see that we have three preseason games now as of 2022-23 season. The regular season, which runs from September until January, is one game a week. The standard game day is a Sunday, but based on primetime TV games, these games may get flexed and changed to Thursday night football, Monday night football, or later in the season we have Saturday games as well. So the standard turnaround is 7 days, but that can vary to a 4 or 5 day turnaround. You can also see here the bye week that each team gets at some point during the mid-season, and as both the Chiefs and the Eagles took the number one seeds in their respective championships, that means they also got a bye week in between the regular season and the playoffs. So there's been 2 weeks between the championship games and the Super Bowl. And so getting the balance between training load and recovery during that time frame is clearly very important. So let's take a more specific look now into that 2 week period. As I said, a normal standard 7 day turnaround, Sunday to Sunday, and we'll take a look at what that microcycle might look like from a periodization perspective. Now, this may not be the case for all teams, but generally speaking, if you have a Sunday game, Monday you might do some sort of recovery, you may have strength and conditioning work in there, and you'll have meetings to debrief the game. Tuesday tends to be the official rest day. There are recovery options available for players to come in, and some may choose to do some strength and conditioning work, but generally this is their official mandated day off in the week. Now, often we hear about in the NFL Victory Monday, particularly later on in the regular season. Teams may, if they win, give the Monday off as well, so then the players may have Monday and Tuesday off. When it comes to recovery, obviously most NFL teams are spoiled for choice, from sleep pods to cryotherapy chambers, hot and cold tubs, saunas, steam rooms, and of course all the tools and modalities on top of that. And if you want real life insight from an NFL team of the tools they have available and how they get used, then I'd recommend this video from the NFL where Steve Smith Senior visits the Buffalo Bills and has a tour of both the strength and conditioning facilities as well as the training room and the recovery tools they have on offer. Wednesday and Thursday tend to be the biggest training days as per other sports periodization models, being furthest from either game. These are the days when the on-field training load is at its highest. Often one of these days may be a padded practice where the players wear their full equipment, and these padded practices are limited both in pre-season and in the regular season how many can be done in total, but also only ever one a week in the regular and post-season. For some teams, Friday is called Fast Friday, where it is a light, sharp practice before a walkthrough on the Saturday, although I understand other teams approach it the other way around, with more a walkthrough on the Friday and then a faster but short, sharp practice on the Saturday before the Sunday game. So if we assign some arbitrary loads for that training week, this is what it might look like. Again, that Wednesday, Thursday generally tending to be the most intense days. But of course, this may change during the season, particularly as chronic fatigue sets in and players need more recovery time. As I said, this is a 2 week training block that the teams have been facing, although they have faced previously these 2 weeks between games when they had their bye weeks and their playoff bye. And so it's interesting to think about, without that game and that load in the middle, on the middle weekend, how do the teams approach their training and their weight room periodization in the lead up to the Super Bowl? And we can actually see from the Eagles' social media some of the evidence here of their strength and conditioning sessions this week. Another decision that will have to be made in terms of the preparation of these 2 weeks leading into the Super Bowl is the equipment that the players wear during their practice sessions. So there's a couple of different levels. I already mentioned pads, which is where they wear their full equipment, but you also have shells, which are lighter versions of the pads. Sometimes you may have a really light practice where you just wear helmets, and sometimes you may just have a walkthrough. And obviously this differing level of equipment can affect the training intensity. So this can be used again to plan that balance between training load and recovery. And in particular, the padded practices are an important consideration, because whilst players rarely enjoy practicing in pads, there is a need, of course, to condition them for contact. And although at this stage of the season they're suffering from the chronic fatigue and the bumps and bruises from throughout the year, they also need to stay conditioned to that level of impact. And in this case, as I said, they don't have that game in between in the middle weekend. So how do teams approach including pads in their practice week, if at all? Another really key area for preparation in the lead up to the Super Bowl is trying to prepare all the different playing positions for the demands of the game. Now, from my own experiences working in American football, this was one of the most challenging but intriguing features of this sport. The massive diversity in athletes and also the positional demands. We have our big linemen up front with the really intense grappling and kind of wrestling like demands. You have your skill players out wide that have to really sprint to try and create space or close space on the defensive side. And then you have your mids as well, your linebackers and your running backs, your tight ends in between. And of course, you have all your specialist demands as well in terms of the quarterbacks and the specialists on special teams of your kickers, your punter, and your long snapper. So it's always a fascinating challenge to try and prepare all those different demands and those both physical and technical and tactical needs throughout the training week. We can have a quick look at some data that really highlights this. So there's some research from Aaron Wellman a few years ago. Now this is with Division I NCAA, so college level football, but still it highlights for us the real difference in physical demands. If we take the tracking data and use the same thresholds for across our playing group, we can see here the difference between a wide receiver and a lineman in terms of the sprint distances covered in a game, the speeds that are hit, and the number of acceleration efforts that are on average involved for those playing positions. So really vast differences. And on top of that, we have the different teams within the team. So offense and defensive players are essentially different teams, but then you also have your special teams portions of play, which is the punt, the kickoff phases of the game, as well as field goal. And generally the players on these phases of the game are made up from different position groups across offense and defense. So they have their primary roles as perhaps a linebacker or a running back or a wide receiver, but you also have to then prepare them for the special teams demands, and these can be really different. So getting the balance right as well, physically and tactically throughout the week, in terms of how you're preparing your players for either their offense and defensive roles, as well as their special teams roles. And that brings me on to another really interesting feature of the game, that because this is a play-by-play game, and because it is scripted out, the game plan obviously is such a crucial part of the game, but also the preparation. Based on the scouting of the opposition, your organization comes up with the best way you think you can beat that team. And that influences your style of play and the plays that you select, which then has a big impact on your training week. Because unlike other sports, say footballs or soccer or rugby, that might prescribe training sessions or drills based on time and the subsequent demands, training sessions in American football are determined by the plays that need practicing based on your weekend's game plan. And of course, again, it's all focusing on the balance between practicing those plays but not having excessive fatigue as well. So here, the tactical and technical demands of executing the game plan need to tie up with the physical demands of how much load we think is suitable for that balance between fitness and fatigue. And once again, it's this interesting structure where the teams have 2 weeks to prepare for this game. For many of them, it is the biggest game of their lives. Obviously, it is the accumulation of the NFL season and what they've all been working towards for an entire year. And so 2 weeks is a long time to have, both physically but also mentally, to prepare. So getting the balance, again, that word of balance, between not having too many meetings, not having too many plays, not having too much practice, but clearly also having enough to physically and mentally prepare for what your game plan will be for the Super Bowl. I think that mental fatigue piece is a massive potential part to play in the Super Bowl. By no means am I an expert in psychology, but it's certainly something to be aware of as sports scientists and, of course, the psychologist or mental skills coach on staff. And as we can see here, the teams, they're already in Arizona, as I'm going to talk about in a moment when we talk about the actual game. And so the Monday of this week leading into Super Bowl was officially termed the opening night. And we can see that there was celebrations and media involvement for these players. So already the hype is there and the demands and the emotion around the focus of this game. So that will certainly be something to manage both on the day but also now in this preparation to the Super Bowl. And my final key consideration in terms of the preparation before we get into talking about the Super Bowl itself is, of course, managing injuries. A critical part of sports science, sports performance, sports medicine support, of course, but now we're dealing with the biggest game of the year and potentially the career. So if ever there's going to be a risk taken on an injury, it's this weekend. But again, the teams have 2 full weeks to prepare, and so how they choose to manage their injuries in that time can make a big difference to the availability and potentially the performance at the weekend. Now, this will come as no surprise to those in North America, but to those outside who are used to perhaps other sports, it may be surprising to hear that in American sports, you have to submit a public injury report on every practice day. So we can actually get some insight into perhaps the practices, but also what's going on with the injuries. So we can take a look here and see the number of players that are listed for both teams, both the Eagles and the Chiefs, with their practice status through the week and then also their game status. This is from last week, which again is a bit of an unusual week. So the Eagles have chosen to not yet specify a game status. And we can see that they gave a large group of players a rest day on their Friday. A notable injury report for the Kansas City Chiefs as well, with a number of players being given questionable status, one with doubtful already, and we can see how they are choosing to manage their players. And of course, one name that jumps out on this list being Chiefs quarterback Patrick Mahomes, with that high ankle issue that he's been dealing with the last few weeks. And Chiefs fans will be delighted to see here that he has a full practice for every practice last week. So something also obviously to keep an eye out for this week. Okay, we talked about the preparation then, the planning that goes into thinking about the training load, the recovery, the weight room program across the 2 weeks leading up to the Super Bowl. But now let's turn our attention to the game itself. One area that for me always involves a lot of consideration around decisions is the travel. Given the size of the US, you are often traveling across multiple time zones and large distances, admittedly in often quite nice planes, but it's still a factor in terms of travel fatigue and the impact that might have on the body. So Super Bowl 57 is in Arizona, and so let's think about the journey from both Kansas City and Philadelphia to the venue. So Kansas City is over 1,000 miles away from Arizona. They are crossing one time zone and it's approximately a 3-hour flight. Now that travel is pretty much double for Philadelphia. They're crossing over two time zones and the distance is double, around 2,200 miles, which makes it about a 5-hour flight for the Eagles. Now, when is the best day and time to travel can be a big decision, particularly, of course, for the international games. But given all the media availability that we already discussed and the demands that go on during Super Bowl week, it seems both teams decided, or perhaps were mandated, I'm not sure, to go out to be out there for this full week. And a little bit of detective work on the two teams' social media shows us that they actually both flew to Arizona on Sunday 5th, so a week ahead of the game, which means, of course, they have ample time to adjust to those slight changes in time zones as well as recover from any travel fatigue. So not a major factor in terms of this game. Of course, the environmental conditions may be a factor, particularly from my own experiences spending time in Buffalo, but picking Arizona for the Super Bowl in February is obviously quite a safe bet. So the weather is forecast to be a nice 20 degrees Celsius or around 70 Fahrenheit. So again, not that shouldn't have a major impact on the physical aspect of the game. One factor that is certainly different, of course, in this game is, of course, the halftime show. Now, halftime is normally around about 12 minutes in an NFL game, pretty brief, in fact. But given the halftime show this year by Rihanna, that halftime period can be anywhere between 20 to 30 minutes. And I'm not sure there's an exact number placed on it as well. So teams should at least be thinking about how they're going to approach this unique situation with a prolonged halftime period. Again, both from a physical perspective, but also the mental perspective. And then, of course, it just comes down to the game itself and whether the game plan, the technical tactical preparations, as well as those physical mental preparations across the entire year, in particular these last 2 weeks, how they impact performance on the day and how players respond to the various contexts and momentum of the game. So we will see on Sunday who will lift Super Bowl 57. So that's my overview of the sports science preparation for Super Bowl 57 on Sunday. If you enjoyed this video, you might want to check out my other videos as well as my blogs on sports science on the Global Performance Insights website, and keep your eyes peeled for my next video coming very soon.